After the brief introduction of FGI over the video, I would like to invite everyone for this particular session. And before we start the session, I would like to give a brief overview of the speakers today. Our speaker, guest speaker for the day, Mr. N.C. Narayanan. He's the founder, chairman of SSA Group of Companies. Mr. Narayanan, fondly known as N.C., is the founder, chairman of SSA Group. N.C. is a gold medalist in mechanical engineering from Anna University and holds a MS in research in computer and aided design from the prestigious IIT Madras. N.C. founded SSA in 1999 with a missionary zeal to transform Indian industries to become globally competitive by transforming the way in which they think and act. N.C. has made significant contribution to hundreds of organizations and thousands of people across multiple countries spanning South Asia, Middle East, and Africa, where he has earned the reputation of a transformation catalyst. Over and above business enterprise transformations, N.C. influences people through various social media, blogs, and books, where he shares his unique perspectives on and self-development. He has been conferred with several awards in recognitions of his contributions to the field of quality and business excellence. Our second guest speaker for the day, Mr. Ganesh Iyer. He is the vice chair of SSA Business Solutions. Mr. Iyer is a graduate chemical engineering from Mumbai University with leadership management program from INSEAD France. He has over 22 years of industrial experience spanning across diverse sectors and last 10 years in business process consulting for strategy, operations, and design and development. Mr. Ganesh has led a number of change management engagements and large-scale organization transformation initiatives. Our third guest speaker, Mr. Naveen Narayanan, he is the MD of SSA International LLC. Mr. Naveen is a mechanical engineer with an MBA in international business from the prestigious Thunderbird School of Global Management, US, where he has inducted to the Beta Gamma Sigma Honor Society for his academic excellence. He also holds a master's degree in Lean Enterprise from the University of Buckingham, UK. He's a certified Six Sigma Black Belt and Quality Improvement Associate from the American Society for Quality and is a certified AFQM assessor. He is currently pursuing his doctoral research in Lean Operational Excellence from the University of Buckingham. He has over 15 years of global management consulting experience in world of lean manufacturing strategy and change management. So this was a very, very brief introduction of our speakers. May I request the president, Mr. Manohar Chawla, to deliver the welcome address, please.
Good morning, everyone. I'm audible?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Our esteemed guest speakers, Mr. N.C. Narayanan, founder chairman of Group of Companies, Mr. Ganesh Iyer, vice chairman, SSA Business Solutions, Mr. Naveen Narayanan, managing director, SSA International. Esteemed participants, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Federation of Gujarat Industries and all of us here, I'm happy to extend a warm welcome to our guest speakers, Mr. N.C. Narayanan, Mr. Ganesh Iyer, and Mr. Naveen Narayanan, who will be conducting today's webinar on profit leadership. I also welcome all the participants present here today in the webinar. The Indian industries were worst affected in the disruptions which were caused by the COVID pandemic. It is certainly comforting to know that the process of vaccination throughout our country is going on. India has also emerged as a major supporter and provider to various countries by exporting the vaccines to them. And this comes as a ray of hope to all of us as we quickly approach towards normalcy in lifestyle and business dealings. FGI has organized today's webinar to improve the morale of today's industries, to foresee post-COVID-19 scenarios, and in order to utilize the potential opportunities in the emerging new normal. Today's webinar aims to shift paradigm of profit leadership with short and long-term strategies. The webinar intends to cover interesting topics such as pre and post COVID scenario for Indian business, potential opportunities due to global trade shift, current weaknesses of industry sectors to utilize the opening market from China, concept of profit leadership, emerging best practices for cost optimization, role of leadership to drive profitability, inventory material and HR cost optimization, and several other insights. I'm sure after the webinar, the attendees will be able to be ready to tap the potential opportunities that could emerge for India. They could also decode the possibility to stay profitable, to understand the profit drivers, to know the concept of profit leakages, to raise organizational morale and think radical. Today, we are fortunate to have with us as our guest speakers, Mr. Narayanan, Mr. Iyer, and Mr. Naveen, who have kindly agreed to share. Sorry, I lost my screen. Yeah, sorry, thank you. We are fortunate to have with us our guest speakers, Mr. Narayanan, Mr. Iyer, Mr. Naveen, who have kindly agreed to share their enriched knowledge and expertise and provide us with valuable guidance on the topic. FGI founded in the year 1918 in the erstwhile Baroda state under the progressive rule of Shriman Sayajirao Gaikwad is an apex industries association and a recognized chamber of commerce in Gujarat, having an illustrious track record of over 102 years in the service of trade and industry. FGI has grown from strength to strength and has blossomed into a mature industries association, providing guidance and handholding the industries of our state and ably representing the pain areas faced by the industries to all the relevant authorities in the state and central government. FGI has also actively and timely provided representations, suggestions and feedback to the state and central government on issues related to taxation, policies and foreign trade. FGI's success over the years is the result of commendable support of my colleagues in the managing committee, the esteemed FGI members, consultants, and the efficient FGI secretariat. It is FGI's commitment to steer the growth of its member industries to greater heights. We shall continue working closely with the government for due implementation of policies and initiatives. And with these few words, I thank you all for your attention. Over to Team SSA.
Thank you, Manoharji, for setting the context. Hope I'm audible, everybody.
Yes, please.
Yes, please.
So I'm going to quickly start with a quick introduction about SSA and then hand over to NC to take the keynote session. Just let me know if...
That's visible, Ganesh.
All right. So without spending, so SSA Business Solutions was founded in 1999 by NC when he quit his corporate career. He comes from a background of automotive engineering and electrical engineering with Lucas TVS and Crompton Greaves, and then set up SSA late in the 1990s. So we are over 20 years in existence. And today, a little bit on NC. So he has written three books. Pragmatic Leadership is his most recent one edition to, which is available on Amazon, which talks about how do you develop leaders within an organization and how do you take them up within the organization to talking about team leadership? How do you talk about departmental leadership? And then how do you talk about organization leadership? And what is the change in the behavior? What is the change in the technology? What is the change in the methods that you must use as you grow up within an organization. On the technical side, of course, very simple to read books, Lean Six Sigma in a nutshell, Enigma of Lean, which tries to demystify the practices which are being used by industry, which are done wrongly, and then help instill the best practice. So these two books are good reads for anybody trying to start these initiatives. Of course, as explained earlier, he also writes voraciously and posts a lot of social articles on Facebook, LinkedIn, and other areas. So if you could connect to him, you would be able to see his other varied topics on self-development, personal leadership, and other areas where you may be interested in. As an organization, SSA, now, today, where we have serviced over 24 countries, done over 1,000 plus business models. We are domain agnostic in the sense that we are trying to look at any business and try to look at it from an angle of how to improve the profitability of that organization. We have delivered over $400 of savings across all industries. While we are headquartered in Mumbai, we have local offices in Oman, Dubai, Sri Lanka, and partners in Thailand, Qatar, and Saudi. So in terms of profitability focus areas, how do we generally engage with organizations? When we look at an organization value stream, primary areas where the saving potentials are there, when we are looking at it from a bottom line perspective, the first and foremost is the conversion cost, the cost to convert your raw material to finished goods. That becomes the primary area where we can focus on. Second is if you are having your own proprietary designs, then the cost of the material is generally one of the largest component to the complete bottom line. So we look at the direct material cost contribution and look at various means in terms of design optimization and how we can improvise that. The third one is the cost of inventory. So when we talk about inventory, we look at all the three, raw material, work in process, and finished good, and try to look at it, how do we optimize these three areas, and what should be an optimum level without having a loss of sale and not impacting the working capital which we are having. While this deals with the main manufacturing flow, the other support functions, which is indirect labor costs, be it planning, be it procurement, sourcing, finance, accounts, all of these also contribute to the cost. And unless these support functions also get enabled in the same lines as the production, usually what happens is they become the bottlenecks. So that again becomes a focus area for us when we do it. Also in service industries, that is the major focus area. Everything is on information flow. So when we look at service industries, be it banking, insurance, others, this becomes a focus area for us. Cost of poor quality. This is one of the biggest challenges to the Indian industry today, where rework rejects cost go anywhere between 2% to 10% and largely hits the bottom line and also the brand of the organization. So looking at cost of poor quality, how do we reduce that? That becomes a main focus. Last but not the least, logistics cost, which means that where do you stock your finished goods or how should the distribution be handled and how you can optimize it so that you don't have any lost sales. This is another area where we focus on. In terms of our clientele, you can see across the regions and across verticals, we have done work in pharma, we have done work in heavy engineering, we have done in discrete manufacturing, electrical engineering, plastic industries across all sectors. In terms of the work packages, what we offer, and these are some of the more recent work packages aligned with the needs of the industry. The first one is vendor integration. A lot of times we find that the ability of an organization to deliver is dependent on the quality of the incoming materials, quality and timeliness of incoming materials. So having a good vendor integration program by which you are able to work and partner with your vendors to get zero defect and reliable cost-effective supply chain becomes essential. So this is one of the areas where we work with large organizations trying to help them create these programs. Second, on the design optimization, as I said, cost-effective design and on time to market. So how do you decide? Because today timeliness is the mantra. If you're early to market, you can capture the market share and that decides your leadership position. So going on time to market is going to become very essential for new product development. When we look at DDMRP, demand-driven material requirements planning for the inventory management, this is something which has happened in the last decade, where a lot of development is happening in terms of looking at how to manage inventory and going into this changing nature of demand, which is there, which is very unpredictable. Sometimes you have very high demand, sometimes you have very less demand. How do you keep your production in line and inventory management in line to those changing demands? That's what the focus of demand-driven inventory is. Lean manufacturing, again, how do you develop flexible manufacturing systems so that these varying demands can be handled? That again is part of the lean manufacturing what we offer. Distribution network, as I already covered, how do you scientifically decide the stocking norms at different areas across different locations in the country and how they should be managed? That's what this focuses on. Now, all this is not going to be complete without having good IT and HRM optimization. So all our change management programs are having in terms of having the right structure in place in the organization and having the right systems, which is going to have required to deliver this. In terms of partnerships, we are affiliates of Demand-Driven Institute based in the US, where we deliver their training programs, which are there on creating the knowledge which is required on the demand-driven planning systems. And we implement an IT solution by B2Wise, which takes into care the IT requirements and integration with ERP systems. So in terms of technology interventions, we help organizations with ERP evaluation, selection, upgrades, production planning, scheduling. How do you need to do it? Because generally ERPs don't get into that minute level of production planning and scheduling for your daily shift-wise schedules, process management systems, performance scorecard automations, project management, inventory optimization. We do assessments for Industry 4.0, where you should focus on what is your current level and how you can improve. These are the areas where we focus on a technology-related aspects. So with that, I will hand over the session to NC for the keynote session.
Thank you, Ganesh. Can you confirm whether you are able to see my screen, Ganesh?
Yes, it's visible.
Good morning to all of you. Thank you very much. Once again, at the outset, let me express my deepest gratitude for the leadership of FGI for giving this great opportunity. And I really admire and appreciate all of you for taking time on a weekend to attend this conference. I had the great privilege of delivering few sessions in FGI in a face-to-face scenario. Of course, because of the current situation that we are adopting these kind of technologies. But still, I'm very happy to share some of my thoughts in this program. Before I get into the subject proper, I just want to set the context of this subject of profit leadership. What is this animal is all about, and then how does it really relate to our current scenario is what I'm going to cover. And then my colleagues Ganesh and Naveen will take you through some more details of how we can go about in the coming years. Of course, ever since the modern business came into existence, of course, the profit is the primary focus of any entrepreneur. So it is needless to say that why are we talking about this topic in a context of current reviving economy. So I just want to set the context of this subject primarily based on my 50 years of corporate life as well as in consulting across the globe. So I thought I'll share some of my thoughts in this program before I hand over to Ganesh. So now the current situation, of course, needless to start in a little bit in a pessimistic way. You see that in this particular slide, I have shown that in the last 1,800 years, we have been hit by some kind of a major pandemic or a war.
every almost maybe every probably World War One, and then we had World War Two, and then various pandemics have been hitting almost once in a century or so. So naturally, this is going to be order of the life. And then every time when there was a global setback, we had different kind of issues. But very strangely, the current pandemic, which is of course in my 70 years of human existence, this is the first time I'm coming across such a major kind of a situation where every aspect of life, be it politics or be it any kind of situation, maybe hospitality or healthcare or you name anything, including industry, growth, finance, I think has been affected by this kind of a pandemic, which is virtually providing a lot of opportunity to revisit the way in which we have been designing and running our business. So instead of painting a very pessimistic picture, so I just want to give you some kind of a hope that this is a great opportunity in disguise. Just looking at the spectrum of Indian industries contributing to the overall GDP, of course, it's a quite a variety of kind of industry segment, although agriculture is our main kind of GDP contributor. But we find that this country has got a very heterogeneous kind of a spectrum of industries. So it's very difficult to say which sector is contributing to the significant part of the Indian economy. Just to cite that FGI may be having a multiple kind of industry entrepreneurs, business leaders coming from different kind of industries. So in order to keep the, you know, perspective across variety of industries, I thought I will take few examples. Like for example, electrical equipment industry. Recently I delivered a lecture on the EMA, where we were trying to figure out 175,000 crores of contribution coming from the electrical equipment industry. About 1.35% of the Indian GDP is contributed by them. And 8.1% of the manufacturing sector is coming from the Indian electrical electronic industries. So that means it's a quite a huge opportunity to look into the future of this transformation that is taking place. So quite interestingly, we are very actively present in the pharma and chemical sector in a big way in terms of bringing efficiency improvement. It's very interesting to see that about India has got the largest number of the FDA, US FDA approvals as compared to many other countries. More than 100 FDA approved industries are there in terms of pharma sector. And then we are the third largest pharma contributors across the world and the fourth generic production manufacturers of generics in India, and 14th in terms of value. So this is something quite interesting to see that we have many strengths and kind of a history for us to look forward to the coming major shakeouts that are happening. So that's the situation on the pharma sector. And we have been doing some kind of special work for pharma sectors, where this huge, can you see here that out of the about 13% of CAGR over the last maybe 8 to 10 years, and there is going to be a sudden increase in the demand in the pharma sectors. And since these industries have got a difficulty of, you cannot just put up another unit and start manufacturing. So it requires a lot of approvals and the regulatory requirements. So there is a huge amount of operational excellence perspectives are coming up in the pharma sectors, which was a little bit complacent over the period of time. So in summary, although this developed economies are going to suffer, as we all notice that all the developed countries are in deep trouble, but whereas the emerging areas seem to be on the Asia Pacific region, So that we have a huge opportunity around the corner, provided we are going to consider this, some of these recommendations that we want to bring about in this program. So that is the outlook. And of course, I'm a very optimistic person. So I just go through the history about in the case of Hiroshima, Nagasaki bomb, you know, 3 million people died in about less than 3 seconds. So 25% of the wealth was devastated in Japan, but you know, they came back as the most emerging economic power in about 30 years time. And by 1980, they became the most formidable contributors for the world's economy. So it is very important at this point in time in India that we have a different outlook rather than getting devastated by the kind of pandemic experience that we have gone through. So it all depends on what way we are going to look into the future. So as a famous saying that we cannot adjust the wind, but we can adjust the sail. So any potential futuristic leadership will always consider how we can see the opportunity in a different kind of problematic scenarios. So looking into the vision of the country, which is proposed by the Chief Prime Minister, we want to become self-reliant, and then we should become equally good in the local as well as in the global scenario. And then we should aim for 10% GDP, which will take us into something of a great future in the coming years. So the whole world is looking at India as the potential emerging economy. It all depends on how we are going to make use of these opportunities in a more positive manner. So the message I just want to bring about is that I was writing different kind of articles about how this pandemic has opened up some new opportunities, rather than looking at it in a very pessimistic way. As you could see that the essence of economic reform in India, talking about technology governance, is quite interesting that you can handle corruption and control of the business more by technology, and our passport Kendra and various other systems government has introduced in order to eliminate corruption is a very good example. So we need to look at that. Global supply chain domination, of course, we have the 135 crore people, highly educated, quite a brilliant kind of brain that our people have. So we have a fantastic opportunity to become the global supply chain, replacing virtually China, provided that we are going to look into that particular opportunities. MSMEs, of course, Ganesh is going to share some more details. MSMEs are the heart of any country. It's extremely important to strengthen this, who have gone through a tremendous amount of impact in the COVID scenario. And then our focus now, all the leadership should focus on the wealth creation. Now, for want of time, I am not getting into the detail. Many organizations have grown in size, in turnover, and other kind of prominence. But unfortunately, the wealth creation point of view, we have plenty of recent examples like Jet Airways or Rajas, and there are well-known names once upon a time. They have all just burst like a bubble. So it's very important to look at the subject of profit leadership is about wealth creation, which we will try and cover it as much as we can in the limited time. And the more important is that we look at crisis as an opportunity. It requires a different kind of a paradigm. As typical Indians, we are generally pessimistic and we look into the problems more than on the solution side. So this current pandemic has thrown tremendous amount of opportunity in order to re-engineer the entire business to become a very, very profitable kind of a proposition. So having said that, now out of my consulting globally, I find there are many business leaders are looking into, let's fix the problem. You know, that's one kind of an attitude. The other kind of an attitude is build an enterprise. So there can be a two different way of looking at it. I think that more positive way of looking at the future is to how we can build the enterprise rather than trying to fix problems, because problems are bound to appear every day. That is what is the kind of lifestyle an entrepreneur is used to. So in this program, we just want to share with you what do you really mean by building an enterprise for wealth creation. Now, there's an interesting analysis that, you know, we all know we want profit basically, because that is the very aim of any business. And that is what part of the business, and how to do it is let's cut cost. So most of the organization at this point in time worldwide, I've got a knee-jerk reaction of cutting cost indiscriminately without realizing that there is a huge opportunities are unfolding. 2021, of course, the budgets are around the corner. There are quite a bit of opportunities are opening from multiple direction. So cost cutting indiscriminately is not the right way of coming out of the problem. But we need to look at into the perpetuity of the organization, how do we sustain our profits. Now, sustaining the profit has got a different kind of approach. I can share with you my experience in our own business that we are able to optimize our cost almost significantly. At the same time, we are able to increase our turnover. So there's a huge amount of opportunity now because of the whole world is shifting to the new paradigm that we will be able to optimize our business value stream. At the same time, we can significantly bring down our cost. So I would recommend that this approach rather than cutting cost indiscriminately. So what is the recommendation is bringing in the design thinking. Many of you must have heard this word design thinking. What does that really mean is, I'll just quickly explain. Revisiting the customer value, that is the first step part of the design thinking. That means what is our organization is delivering value to the customer. That's the starting point. But there are many things that we are doing in the organization which are generating waste, in the sense that it consumes our cost, but it is not really adding any value to the organization as well as to the customer. Then there are huge amount of technology innovations have happened. It is innumerable amount of innovations have happened. If you probably regularly reviewing your LinkedIn, you will find using this opportunity, there are many, many disruptive innovations have happened in the last 1 year. So there are huge amount of opportunity of innovation in our own organization. And I want to draw your attention that re-engineering the value stream, there is a phenomenal opportunity is there. Now, there are so many costs that we are incurring, which are neither adding value to the customer nor to the business. So the entire value stream thinking, so for want of time, I'm not getting into too much of detail, but I would urge you to read my post in LinkedIn. I'm regularly writing about this subject. I would invite you to go through that. And then optimize cost rather than trying to cut cost. It's a very important thought process that we want to bring about. And when Naveen and Ganesh is going to talk, they will give you some more perspectives on this. And finally, profit is becoming a byproduct rather than something we need to run behind. It's very important to shift our attention, not looking into the lag indicator, what they call it in balance scorecard. Profit is a lag indicator. So if we do many things right, probably we will be able to arrive at a much better profitability. So I'm going to give you a very interesting information that 20 to 30% of the current cost that we are incurring can add up to your profitability. I'm not just pulling a fast one out of my hat, but this is something what we have seen in many, many organizations. There's a possibility. That's the idea of the profit leadership is all about. So having said that, how do we go about? There are many organizations which are currently having a difficult time. So that means there must be a strategy for year of recovery. When I say recovery, means that we try to come out of the current difficulties and then at least keep the head above the water. And then we should also plan for consolidation. That means unless otherwise we have a year of consolidation where we utilize the various opening opportunities and also plan for a year of excellence. So now most of the leadership are considering that maintaining the status quo is not going to head us anywhere. So we need to have a clear strategy for 3 years, how we are going to improve our profitability and create a highly competitive business. So having said that, let me spend a few minutes on the effect of globalization as well as the kind of transformation that is likely to happen. So now there is a concept of Pangaea, which was the mass of all the earth land were together a long time back, 200, 300 million years ago. But they got separated in the same way. The economy also became fragmented, but the whole world is moving in terms of how we can attract the foreign investment. In the last 1 year, India had the largest amount of foreign investments happening. And also the government of India is constantly working on how to improve our index for easiness to do business, which was moving from, I don't know, this may be a little old figure, but continuously this is the direction the world is moving. And even countries in Oman, like where we are present, once upon a time it was a very closed economy, but it is all opening up to bring in foreign investments. So having said that, there's another interesting aspect in this particular slide I want to share with you. Out of the 7.8 billion people in this planet, that many human beings are there in this planet, almost 65% of the people are living in the underdeveloped and developing countries. And the balance about 35% of the people are living in the developed countries. Very interestingly, if you see the wealth creation, almost two-thirds of the wealth creation is brought by this one-third of the people. And the entire two-thirds of the people are generating only one-third of the wealth of this planet. So it's very important for particularly India to review this. Why wealth creation in our country or in our region in Asia Pacific is not as much as the developed country? So this program to a certain extent will answer this, but I want you to keep this at the corner of your mind. So this is just showing from the year 2010 to 2050, who is going to be the most superpower economy. Of course, US was dominating till 2020. Gradually China is stepping in as the most rich country in the world. Once upon a time, India and China were almost trailing together. But how did they move forward is something very important to appreciate. But at the same time, India is now moving in the up in the ladder, which was not at all there so maybe about 10, 15 years ago. So there is a huge opportunity for Indian entrepreneurs to support the leadership of the country to move forward towards the most successful economy in the world. So what do we do actually? There are a few things that I thought I will bring it to your notice. One is that once upon a time, we were in a protected economy. So whenever the cost is increasing, we used to pass on the cost to the customer. But protected to global economy, when it is happening, customers have become much more wiser now. So we will not be able to pass on the increasing cost to the consumer. So that means we will have to find a way of optimizing our cost so that we can retain our profitability and remain competitive. So how do we do that? That means we need to enhance the value perception to the customer. At the same time, we need to look at our entire value stream, the way in which our business design is functioning today. Wherever that a lot of work has been done by us in the Middle East as well as in the Asia Pacific countries, neighboring countries, we found there's a phenomenal opportunity to bring down about 20% of our current cost without affecting anything in the organization. So in summary, you will find that the macroeconomics are going through a big issues because most of these developing countries have all got a heavy dependency on certain kind of resources. And then also you will notice that the microeconomic level, we have very low efficiency. None of the benchmarks are comparable. We have got a depleting margin. We have got an eroding customer loyalty, cost is rising, and stakeholder satisfactions are also suffering. So these are the aspects of a typical developing countries industries at this point in time. I think it's a time for us to turn around this and then become the most efficient manufacturers in the country. So having said that, there are two types of reactions are happening in the globalization scenario. The reactive leadership, which was dormant and happy about the status quo, they are all shutting down. And the proactive leadership companies are trying to look at opportunities from all this kind of a turmoil. So it's very important to see once upon a time, Thomas Cook or, you know, this kind of industries have closed down, but Southwest continuously made profit even in spite of the global downturns. So it's very important to look into it. So the
Sir, I'm sorry to interrupt you. There are a few people mentioning that they're not able to hear because they're listening from the lap speaker. So can you, because headphone, it is very clear, but on the laptop speaker, those who don't using, you are not using headphone, they're not able to hear properly. So could you come closer to the laptop or something? Just a request from the team.
How is it now? Is it better?
Yeah, 1 second, sir. I'll just say it from the speaker. Yeah, can you say something, sir?
Yeah, can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Hello? Yeah, I'll it's still a little low. Can you say something now?
I'm almost closer to the screen. My laptop. So is it clear now? A little better? Those who are listening from the mobile phone, is it?
Yeah, those who are listening directly from the laptop, they are not able to hear it very clearly. Xavier, is there any setting that we can do? Because even he's very close to the laptop, but not...
I guess this is audible now. We can continue. No problem.
Better? Oh, okay. All right, sir. Thank you.
Sorry about that. So I think I got used to this setting. So far, I didn't have any problem. So let's continue. So I will speak a little louder because for others, probably I may be too loud, but kindly bear with me. So the business leaders' agenda or profit, growth, perpetuity, as well as the image is the main agenda of the business leaders. And today you find they are always in a problem-solving mode, trying to fix the problem. They have very limited time to look into the future. So it's extremely important to break this kind of problem-solving, firefighting mode. Unless otherwise we do that, if you look at the performance versus time, you will find a typical Asian industry is much lower than the typical world-class industry. You compare the inventory levels or the delivery performance or on-time delivery or compliance to the committed plan or the quality levels in Sigma. Whatever you compare, that we are much lower than the international best-in-class. So in order to make the Atmanirbhar kind of becoming local as well as global, we need to catch up with this kind of improvement, which require a step change. That means in a very shorter period of time, we need to bring in a quantum improvement, which require the leadership focus on continuous improvement and organizational transformation, etc. So how do we do that? So the changes are required in the organizational structure, the systems, and then the culture aspect of the industry. That means unless otherwise, we are going to focus on these things. Profit leadership is a way of looking into the organization through a microscope. That is what is the intent of the whole program today. So essentially, if you have to build competitiveness across the globe right now, quality, cost, delivery, safety, service, and relationship is becoming extremely important. So the last item is, of course, is just I want to draw your attention, and safety is becoming a more critical aspect of this competitiveness development. So before I hand over the session to my colleague, I just want to draw your attention. This is a research carried out by some of the leading companies, which shows that the organizational development in terms of quality, which shows that this x-axis is showing the sigma level. A typical pharma industry, of course, some of my pharma colleagues did not agree with me. In the last program I spoke, but this is a published information. That means they are in the stage two, which is essentially about 2 to 2.5, 3 sigma maximum. But whereas at automobile industries have reached closer to 6 sigma, and aerospace has reached the 7 sigma. For those who are not very much conversant with the sigma scale, 6 sigma is about 3.4 parts per million, and 3 sigma is 3 out of 1,000 products we produce has got a defect. So that means we are heavily dependent on the quality control, as we could see for most of the pharma industries are highly regulated, and then they are more on the quality control aspect. And the quality assurance and quality management is the science that we need to move about, which require a very systematic way of investigation. So just to cite an example, the pharma sector, we have just compared recently with the annual productivity improvement in the pharma sector is about 2%, whereas automobile improves by 10% every year. Production lead time in days is about 150 days in a pharma company. Automobile is just 4 days. They build an automobile from raw material to finished goods in just 4 days. Inventory, 75 days inventory we hold in a typical pharma company as a comparison. Automobiles are holding only 16, one-fourth of the inventory levels for their size of the operations. Labor value added time is only 20% in a pharma company. We have been working on a lot of pharma operational excellence. So we are collaborating with these figures which have been published recently. And automotive companies have got 65% utilization of the human productivity. So that is what I thought I will probably set the tone for the profit leadership subject. And my colleague Ganesh and Naveen will give you much more deeper perspective, because my session was hovering around 40,000 feet level of seeing the future opportunity. So I'll take some questions and your comments at the question answer session at the end. Over to you, Ganesh.
Thank you, NC. I will start my presentation now. The topic which I am going to focus on is the context of the MSME industry. What they can do right and how they can improve. So what is the reality check in MSME industry? What the challenges are being faced by the MSME industry and what they can do about it? Am I audible and screen is visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thanks. All right. So if you really see, now NC mentioned about the comparison with China, where we were at one point, probably around the 70s, around the same place. And today, if you see, while both the countries have similar amount of MSME percentage contribution, which is around 98% here and 99 over there, what is the significant difference is the percentage employment and the GDP contribution, right? So what it means is the size of MSME, which is there in India versus the size of MSME in China is very different. You know, a normal company, which is a MSME in China would be a very large organization in India. Probably that's one of the things. Now, one inference from this is the MSME in India are not willing to take risks to grow beyond a certain stage of operations, right? That is one of the reading on the wall saying that we are happy with what we are doing, But when it comes to growing it or taking it to the next level, going public, probably that is where there is some amount of resistance to change. So in terms of the assessment itself from a SWOT level, if you really see our industry, we have very good technical competency. We have excellent experience in manufacturing, the best brains in the world, proven track record, good infrastructure. Labor is, I would say, cheap. If not cheap, it's average. And there is a lot of help in terms from the associations and other bodies which are there in terms of help. However, some of the areas where we really need to focus on and the opportunities for change which is there is one is the quality image which we have. It is very, very not reliable. So I will say the quality, there are two aspects to quality. One is quality at source. So we ensure that no bad product goes out. So there is, as NC mentioned, quality control is very good. We ensure that nothing is going out. But because of the quality control focus, what happens is our cost increases because the amount of rejection, rework, everything goes up. This also has an impact on the reliability of the products. Our focus on updating to latest automation or technology is less. It is better as compared to other countries such as the Middle East, definitely. But still, we are far behind other Southeast Asian countries. Labor management is poor. Integrity levels better than China, definitely. However, there is a lot there to improve in this particular area. Our supply reliability, I talked about it, the challenges and our focus areas on vendor management and ensuring right first-time supplies. So ensuring getting good reliable supplies is also one of the challenges. So if you are a supplier to a particular customer, we need to look at on-time in full deliveries and with right qualities, that becomes a major factor. Adoption of best practices, you know, this is something which is lacking. The knowledge levels are there. There is no question about it. You know, you go to any industry, you ask them what best practices they have done, 5S, they have done TQM, they have done Six Sigma, they have done Lean, everything they know. But if you really see the shop floor, the application point of view, it's very poor. So there is a gap between knowing and doing. And I think a large amount of those also focus on poor accountability management practices, which is there, and focus on saving rather than investment, looking at larger returns for future. It's a more short-term focus than a long-term focus. So what are the opportunities which have realized in the last 1 year due to this changing environment? One is there is an acceleration for Make in India. So there is a large amount of focus, a lot of funds are coming in, a lot of support systems are coming up in terms of accelerating the Make in India. The other thing is we are seeing a large amount of change in the demand patterns from customers. Customers are now asking whether instead of making one particular component, if we can provide them the complete end product, which means that our ability to focus on a larger assembly lines is going to be more important in terms of getting into more number of different manufacturing practices, which will help us to give the complete product. So this is another area where we have to start focusing on in terms of meeting the opportunities which are coming up. So they no longer want only one component and somebody else assembles, they want the end product to be made completely. Manufacturing for global markets, of course, the China fallout has created a lot of opportunities, but I don't think the Indian industries were ready to capture these opportunities which are coming up. We are not seeking these opportunities also actively, the MSME specifically. They are just waiting for somebody else to come and reach out to them, rather than they going out and finding those markets. Work on our advantages, such as the better manufacturing knowledge and low labor costs. That is something which we have to do. We have to focus a little bit more on the exports. That is an opportunity area. MSME industries should exploit it now. As I said, this is something which is very, very correlated in terms of the opportunity which exists today. And the most important to meet this particular requirement, we need to ensure that we invest in our people, in our process, and develop the competencies which are required to deliver for these markets. Now, if you really look at it in the MSME context, these are generally owner-driven, founder-driven organizations, which are probably in the second and third generation now, who are taking over and running the companies. The founder is very passionate. He would kill himself for ensuring the success. So that is the aggression with which this organization was set up in the MSME. And it is handed over to the second gen, where it's being taken up for globalization, for expansion, for growing the growth, bringing in new technology, all that has happened. And then when we look at the next generation itself, then we are looking at, you know, the generation which is what we say the silver spoon generation, right? Where everything is given to them. There is they haven't gone through the rigor of the hard work or the challenges which have been faced by the founder or the second gen, and they are just looking at managing what has been set up. So there is a mindset shift. There is a change in which the appreciation for challenges is different. And this is some of the MSME challenges which we are seeing in large number of organizations. Now, as we go ahead and understand this, you know, globally, we know that less than 5% of family-run organizations last beyond four generations. And this is a global known fact. And what really happens is, you know, starting from the third gen onwards is where we see there is generally a deterioration and decline happens, where they diversify into some other areas where they would want to pursue rather than continue with the founder's business. And that is another concern area. So unless the transition from a family-run business to a professional-run organization happens around this time, it is very hard to sustain. And that this again goes back to my first point, which I was making, is this shift in mindset has to happen in the MSME sector to move from family run to a professional run company and then take it up into a different level so that this growth can happen irrespective of whether the family controls or not. So that is something which is lacking in the MSME sector. So what are the challenges? Now, I have talked about the reality check. If you really see what happens is as the different generations come in, and different people take up different roles in the organization, the role clarity is not there. The classification of, you know, generally somebody does marketing, somebody does take care of new products, somebody takes care of manufacturing. But within that, if you really look into the details of how the measurement of these roles are, how do we ensure the support is required and coming, those are fairly lacking. Again, the control of power is largely there with the founder, the earlier generation. So how the power sharing, what decision making happens, usually all the decision making stops at the top of the organization, and every small request also goes up, which can make it very difficult for growth point of view. So unless they start thinking about how to create more responsibilities, more accountabilities down the line, this challenge is going to be there. As we are sharing the power, also the wealth sharing concept has to happen. The transparency generally which is required is not there at the group level. So this is something, another area which we can focus on to start looking at how to create structures around governance and create these opportunities. Around wealth sharing. When we talk about the vision for future, this is again related to the role clarity. You know, how do you align all the people of the organization, the leadership specifically, to a common vision of the organization, right? How do you drive everybody to a common vision? this is an area which is very strongly linked in terms of the power sharing. So a lot of people go in disparate directions. They say that we will do B2C now, we will go B2B. There is, as you go into the next generation, there is a need for reaching out to larger markets. So there is a tendency to move towards B2C. And then there is a, and you are not aligned as an organization to cater to the B2C needs and requirements. These are some of the challenges which are coming up. So vision and purpose of enterprise go hand in hand. Unless we define and understand the core existence of your organization, what is the value that you add to society, there is generally a gap in terms of how we look at ourselves, how we can look at what value we can add. Competency gap, this is a very serious problem in organizations as they are growing. While there have been technocrats who are running the show in terms of managing everything day to day, unless their knowledge and competencies are developed across the organization in different areas, there is going to be no growth. So what happens is whatever has been made managed at a particular level in the past, and you're sustaining that, but not necessarily trying to grow it by doing new technology, doing new methods, new manufacturing best practices. So unless there is a constant investment into these particular areas, and this can only happen when you enable the people in the organization to start looking at and develop these kind of capabilities and other things. So the first is the awareness level, and second is the acceptance, and third is actually doing it. I talked about the governance. This is linked to the power and wealth sharing. How do you manage decision making? Where does the governance level happen in terms of the board actually being formed and having a proper decision making across the board? Last but not the least, the area of succession planning. How do we manage that is again a big question. As we really go from the second generation onwards, I think this becomes a very, very crucial question to be answered by the MSME, to start thinking about it and putting it in paper so that they can start ensuring that the organization which has been created does not degenerate. So if you really look at it, when we spoke to many MSMEs, what happened, the kind of responses which we got in terms of why, one of the tendencies is that for the degenerations is they keep blaming the external policies which are not within their control. Rather than looking at these things which are very much internal to them, the tendency is to blame the external factors which are contributing to the degeneration, rather than they accepting the lack of these challenges or the lack of the focus on these challenges are getting them down. So one is the mindset is more towards saying that, okay, the environment has changed and that is why we are not doing good. Second, they don't want the external professionally managed organizations for the fear of losing control. Now, this is an area, again, something which we will have to break free, at least from the second gen onwards, to ensure that we bring in professionals to start managing it and manage through them. So as Apple CEO said that, if I need to get a work done, I need to get somebody who is more smarter than me to get the work done. So unless that level of confidence and capability is not built within the whole system of hiring professionals, taking people who are smarter, brighter than you, and then getting the work done is going to be challenging. Lack of interest in family business. We touched based on this. Second and third generation or the fourth generation does not want to join the family business. So what kind of environment do we create? What kind of focus do we give? And how do we manage family and business? So, these are two words which have to be looked at side by side, right? What does the business give to the family? What does the family give to the business? How do you align and take it ahead in a structured manner is something which has to be done. The lack of customer focus. Focus is more on profit. And then this is where, again, the preventing the ability to invest in new technology, new process and other things is all linked to the mindset. So unless we change the mindset that come what may, we have to have a customer first attitude, ensure that, and a cost focus attitude, this profitability focus will really drive us in the wrong direction. So unless we are going to look at all the metrics, you know, this can be one of the metrics, but cannot be the only metric. Inadequate quality focus. I mentioned this. The focus is on quality control at the end of the line, at the finished good level. But that has to change into how do you drive quality assurance? Because I do find the amount of rework and rejection is too huge in the organizations. A lot of times it is the appreciation that this is a rework or a reject and how it impacts the growth is not realized by organizations. You know, it is given for a fact and they take it as granted that this amount of rework, which is 3%, 4% is going to exist. It is an industry become a standard and they don't realize that this is going to, if we don't do it right, there is an opportunity to save more. So this quality focus has to happen at all levels, focus on right from the RM onwards, because a lot of times I find that since these owners are involved in the decision-making for purchasing, they do a lot of opportunistic purchasing, which means that there might be compromises at the quality level, at the RM level, which results in a lot of rework, which is happening because of this. So you do opportunistic buying, you think that you have saved some money for the organization, but you end up spending more in your conversion cost and then doing the rework and rejections. And then you face a lot of higher cost, which is there. So if you really do a trade-off between the savings, which is done at an opportunistic buying versus the cost of poor quality, I think that level of decision-making does not happen. Lack of robustness in system and process. The delivery capability, which we are talking about, this is where we are saying how we build in credibility, right? So one is price, which we definitely is a given, which is driven by the market conditions, but also can be driven by the kind of quality and consistency which you give can give you a higher or lower price point. So this is where we focus, you know, organizations have to invest onto the aspect of quality delivery and reliability. So reliability is product quality over time, right? So while the product may work for the given period of time in the first few weeks or the first few months, how reliable is it as it goes on and on? Is the same quality being delivered across the whole lifespan of the product? That is the challenge again. And why is it a challenge? Because we haven't really focused on how to build reliability into products. So when you design a product, we design for ensuring that it meets the quality standard in terms of the target, the specification limits which are required. So these are some things which are there. The quality focus is still there. But then when you ask about reliability focus, that how do you ensure that you're testing this over the lifespan of the product? These are areas which are lacking, where organizations have to start investing in putting in better technology, better checks in their whole process to make it happen. And how do you measure across the organization? What are the key performance indicators, right? So always there is one or two key performance indicators which are going to drive the efficiency of the organization. So looking at every process efficiency, the measures of the operational efficiencies, the measures of how your conversion ratios are, the measures of your stock turnover ratios. So there are multiple metrics which you can look at multiple levels, which can drive the efficiency across departments and functions. So having right measures will drive the right efficiency. So a lot of these things are also lacking in terms of putting in the right measures across the organizations. So how do we go ahead from here, given that these challenges are there, these are recognized? First level is to develop the skills. Now the skill development can happen either a bottom up or a top down. You know, these are two options which are there. Our recommendation is to do definitely start with the top down, because unless the management, the leadership and management is willing to first change their mindset and their thinking, that will never translate into a change functionality at the functional level. So our approach is to start top and then take it up bottom up in terms of trying to drive more and more improvements across various functions, which would yield better results. Now, some of the examples of profit leakages, we have seen that, very specifically drilling down into what challenges are there operationally. This is in the plastic industry when we were looking at, there is a lot of time wasted in terms of, because the product variety is increasing. Today, what is happening is you don't want one product of large volume, but you have multiple products of lower volumes which are being manufactured. So there is a need, our whole manufacturing practice has to start changing the dyes and other requirements, setup requirements, changeover requirements are becoming high till you get a right first time product, right? So there is also a lot of rework rejection happen because of this. But we haven't invested into the change of our manufacturing processes to cater to this particular changing demand. Now, this is where some best practices which have to be implemented can be looked at. Single minute exchange of die is something which the automotive industry has implemented. If you see a Toyota line or a Mahindra line or a Bajaj line, the first scooter can be different from the second scooter, can be different from the third scooter, and everything happens very easily without having to do major changeovers. So how the ability to do that becomes very, very crucial. Again, the defect contribution could be different. Your contribution of defects from the process related areas, from the raw material related areas, from the utility related areas. So unless we get down into the solving the defects, a lot of industries have some root cause analysis processes, and then they need to invest in CAPA as a process. So corrective action, preventive action. So how do you correct a particular defect which is happening? And how do you prevent it from happening again? Unless you start investing in these kind of procedures and processes for continuous improvement, you will continue to have the bottom line erosion, which is there. And how do you measure productivity? So you have people, it is not that work is not happening. You go to any industry, they are working 24/7, a lot of work is happening. But how much of that is really value-adding work, which is giving you the right product, versus you're doing rework or getting some wrong products? So looking at the metrics helps us to drive some of these productivity measures. A simple example from a packaging industry where we were looking at, every process, be it gluing, be it the packing slitting, be it the printing or the packing roll, you can see that here we have captured how many actions are value-adding, how many are non-value-adding, and required for the business in terms of reporting, compliance, and those kind of activities which are there. You can see that on an average, about 25% activities are NVA. And this is where NC was talking about 20 to 30% profitability gain can happen if you really focus and reduce these NVA activities which are happening, question why they are happening, and then eliminate them. And this requires some amount of thinking differently. The lean thinking helps to eliminate these. One is the appreciation identification, but how to solve it also requires some amount of deliberation and solving capabilities. And this is where we help industries to drive that growth of 20 to 30%. NC talked about the dependency on China. In the plastic industry, it is mold making. In the pharma industry, it is the API thing, and many more areas we have seen that there are large amount of dependencies. This also becomes an opportune area for industries which want to get started. Developing, creating molds in-house is not as complex. It is the size and timeliness which is what we need to focus on. Today, the technologies are available which can help us to do that in the right fashion. Poor housekeeping and cluttered layout internally. How we are organized within the factories also tells upon how we manage and do it. So when you look at it, there is so much amount of non-moving dead inventories which are piled up and stocked up. Why do you want to keep that? Because it is showing as an asset. Our whole accounting practices, how what we report, everything has to have a change in terms of how we look and manage it. Investing in technology, single piece, single touch equipment, robotics, these are things where very few organizations have taken the leap forward, leap of faith, trying to help, and they are gaining the most. So the people who are willing to take risk into these areas are gaining more because they are getting more predictable in their output. They are reducing the defects which are happening and are able to deliver things faster on time. So I think this is a matter of change in mindset to happen and then take the risk, look at it not as a cost, but rather as an investment, which will help you to grow. Not keen to implement best practices. We talked about this across the whole value chain, be it in the production or in the support function, not able to focus and drive these. You have it for namesake, but not from a point of view by which it is delivering value. So how do you change that whole mindset in the industry is important. To end my closing statement for the MSM industries, the time is ripe for change. Time is always ripe for change. You have to continuously change, else you are going to go out of existence. So change is the most thing which is constant. So the idea is, you know, it can never be a better time than now to change when we are looking at starting fresh, starting again from 2.0. And want to close out with a quote from Helen Keller, where she says that the only thing worse than being blind is having sight but not having the vision. I'd want to close with that. Thank you. And I'll hand it over to Naveen to take over the next session now in terms of what are the next best practices which can be implemented.
Thanks, Ganesh. I hope my screen is visible. I saw some comments about the audio not being loud enough. I just wanted to check if audio is loud because I could hear Ganesh fairly loud and clear.
It is loud and clear. Please go ahead.
Thank you. All right. So just picking up from where Ganesh left in terms of setting the context. Okay, sorry. All right. So when we talk about the profit leadership, I mean, this is something that came up during the lockdown about a year ago when we were debating or deliberating with many of our clients about coping with the onslaught of the lockdown and the economic headwinds that were faced by the industries back then. And it emerged that a number of industries came forward and they said, we would like to be proactive to identify the opportunities to become profit leaders in our industry, notwithstanding the fallout of the pandemic and so on. So this actually ended up being a very interesting exercise with a number of industries, and I'll share some experiences and accounts as we go along in this part of the presentation. So what really is profit leadership? It's basically a holistic approach to enhance profits by focusing on value delivered to customers. Now, oftentimes we find that, when we do the annual budgeting exercise, we are in the last quarter now, and we may be going through reflections on what we had budgeted at the start of the year and how our P&L is likely to look as we close the books. Oftentimes you will find that there is a significant difference between what we expect our business performance and what ends up being the reality. And there are multiple reasons why there is a big gap or delta between the two. And oftentimes you cannot simply attribute them only to external factors, which usually when you talk to managers in the front line, you will hear that, customers change their mind, suppliers didn't deliver in time, or shippings didn't arrive, and so on. So you will find the general tone is that we tend to blame external factors, right? But oftentimes there are a lot of internal reflections that are warranted, how better we can manage our internal operations so that we are able to minimize the difference between expected or entitled profit and realized profit. So what really is profit leadership? If you see within any industry, you know, not every player within the industry operates at the same level of profitability. You know, some time ago, I was doing some analysis of the paint industry. You know, there is a wonderful book called as Unusual Billionaires, written by a gentleman called Saurabh Mukherjee, which does a wonderful comparison of the paint industry in India. And he talks about one leader in the industry, which as all of us know is Asian Paints. Now, paint industry happens to be a very generic industry. It's the lowest entry barrier. It requires very minimal capital expenditure and very minimal technology advancement in the industry overall. But a company like Asian Paints has consistently trumped its industry, be it in terms of top line growth or in terms of bottom line growth, which is also reflected in the performance of its shares, even in very stressed times for earnings. So a lot of it is to do with not just how the industry performs. Now, one can say paint industry is generic and competition is there, but how we are able to differentiate ourselves in the industry and achieve industry leading profits. I highly encourage you to look up on the research done in this regard in this book, and you will find a lot of things, nothing to do with industry dynamics, but everything to do with how they chose to run their industry. So aiming to become the lowest cost producer, perpetuity through value adding, and image as a well-respected player in the industry. Now, some years ago, this was published in a book called Demand-Driven MRP, where they were analyzing the return on investment performance of industries in the US. This was very startling revelation that found that actually since the 1970s, the industries have deteriorated in their return on investment. Now, this is a very curious case. You know, the last 50 years has been the era of very explosive GDP growth, world GDP growth. The global output has grown about eightfold in the last 50 years. And many, many industries, new industries have come up. The automotive industry has had explosive growth and so on. All said and done, the return on investment for a typical industry has depleted. And one may wonder what has gone wrong. Right, return on investment ideally should increase, but which also indicates that the operating expenses have gone up, the complexities have increased, and therefore industries in general have lost the plot in terms of generating greater shareholder wealth. Now, any entrepreneur who invests in a business will think that I believe that I can generate X amount of profit in my business. Let's call that as an entitlement profit, which means that if all the numbers add up, we should be able to generate, let's say, 15% or 20% return on investment or return on capital employed. Now, you may think that it's attractive because if you put that money in the bank or if you put that money in fixed deposit, that may generate a return of, let's say, 6%, 8% or whatever the attractive returns are. So obviously, when you put the money in the business, you would expect that it generates at least twice the return that a risk-free investment would generate. Right. So let's say we believe that the business has the potential to generate that amount of profit. But the reality ends up being different in many cases, not always, but more often than it's comfortable to address. So which means that we expect the business to generate a higher return, but it ends up generating inferior returns than what we anticipate. So this is the concern that we are trying to address, right, which is what we call it as the profit erosion in the business. And as I mentioned earlier in the talk, that a lot of the levers for profit erosion are not just external. Yes, there are external factors. You know, if you look up the dictionary definition of an enterprise, it says that an enterprise is one that offers challenges. So that means you cannot run a business without challenges, right? It constantly puts the entrepreneur in a very uncomfortable position to be able to take decisions, be it to do with customer demand or employee demand or supplier demand, you name it, right? Enterprise often offers challenges, and oftentimes you are putting off one fire after another. Now, having said that, the gap between the you know, the target and desired profit is what becomes the area of focus also for the business, right? There are many, many things that can be addressed within the business which can help us to bridge the gap. Now, recently, you know, last month, we started an engagement here in Oman with one of the facilities management industries. Now, Although we have known about the facilities management industry, it was our first experience to actually consult with one of them. And in my past conversations with the FM industry, usually people... sorry, is there a problem with my slideshow?
I mean, the slide was not changing.
Yeah.
Is it? Yes, that's strange. It is strange. I didn't get any prompt from the... Let me reshare my screen. Maybe that helps.
Just you can quickly show those slides where he spoke. Yeah.
Just can you confirm if you can see my slides now?
Yeah, we are able to see it
now. Yes.
Strange, because maybe the internet held up. So anyway, I didn't... I was in... my fourth slide. Okay, so this was a slide on the return on investment performance, where I was talking about the depleting ROI performance of industries. So, and this was a slide I was talking just now about the gap between entitled profit and the realized profit of the industry. Is it all good now? So first, can you give me a quick feedback?
Yes, Naveen, it's quite good.
All right. So, okay, I hope I didn't lose my train of thoughts. So, yeah, I was talking about the facilities management industry, where it's not that in the past we haven't spoken to the FM industry, and oftentimes they will come back to me and say that, you know, our industry is very simple. Client says, I need 100 people, and therefore we mobilize those 100 people and send them on site. And every month we send a bill to the client for the 100 people we deployed. And we get paid. So there is nothing we can do better about how we run our industry. And believe it or not, I was convinced by their argument until I came across the industry leader in facilities management in Oman, right? They reached out to us, the CEO and the CFO reached out to us and said that we are very unhappy about how our industry is run. And I was taken aback. I said, boss, in these difficult times, you're the only industry that is still making profits and growing. You know, I would like to know more. Why do you feel you are not happy with the way your industry is run? They said there are, you know, the people within our industry, they are settled in their comfort zone. And they believe that everything we do is correct. And we want to challenge that notion. And I said, okay, can you tell me what is really affecting the profitability of your business? And they came up with a long list of things. You know, they said, we have to put people in labor camps and they have to be transported every day in the morning to different sites and they have to be brought back. And we think that the fuel expenses are more, the vehicles are not going fully utilized, the vehicles are idling, drivers are not disciplined in terms of utilizing the fuel, maintenance costs are out of whack. We have so many things that our people who are settled in their comfort zone in operations are now accepting them as a norm in the industry. And as we dig deeper into the process, we were shocked to see that many of their big vehicles, the 18-ton trailers, for example, which is used for shipping material, it is used only 40% to capacity. And four vehicles are going to the same site on a given day because of poor planning of material dispatches. So when you dig deeper into how the operations are run, you will be surprised to see how many profit leaks there are in the business, right? And unless attention is given to these issues, unless people are made to believe that not all is good, all is well in the industry, and there are many, many areas of discontent where we need to keep working on, you will end up in this scenario where your profits will always be lower than what you richly deserve as profits. So what profit leadership really means is that to help generate greater return on investment for the shareholder, right? And we all understand the ROI formula, right? In order to increase greater returns, you need to obviously increase your profits, and achieving those profits with lower capital employed in the business is the holy grail, right? The ideal business is a zero capital business, right? If you see Airbnb or Uber made a lot of news during the pandemic, people said these guys are going to go out of business, but Airbnb had a astronomical valuation when they got listed. And Uber survived and so on. And there is very interesting reason why these businesses are resilient. On one hand, they are aiming to go with the zero capital invested in the business, which may be the ideal true north. Airbnb doesn't own any assets. Uber doesn't own any of the cars. So on one hand, the industries are moving towards minimizing the capital invested in the business. And on the other hand, they are trying to see how best we can generate or maximize profits that we generate in our businesses, right? This has been the constant quest. And unless we are consistently working on these areas within our industry, we may end up with erosion of ROI. You know, one example is that in the automotive world, I don't know if any of us are in the automotive supply chain, the automotive OEMs have a simple policy that they build it into their contracts to all their suppliers. They say every year we want to reduce the cost by 5% or 10%. And therefore, if you're supplying 100 rupees per component today, next year you will have to supply at 90 rupees, and the third year you'll have to supply at 80, 85 rupees, and so on and so forth, right? So inherently, discounts are built into the contract. And there is a reason why they do that. It is because they believe that there is a lot of inefficiencies built into any industry. And unless you have this sword hanging on your head to remove those inefficiencies in the business, you will end up, you know, the cost will keep inflating, and that cost get passed on to the OEMs and in turn to the customers. The facilities management case, the CFO was mentioning yesterday that you guys are in your comfort zone, right? If I'm going to tell you that I will remove two more trucks from circulation from next month, you will somehow find a way to make the rest of the trucks more productive and utilized. So unless that pressure is built into the system, you will find that the ROI will continue to erode. So the two key levers are, of course, efficiency and effectiveness, wherein efficiency is simply meeting the objective by minimizing the resources that are put in, because customer does not care how many vehicles you have for dispatch or how many trips you need to take to deliver the people, but they care about on-time arrival of vehicles and people. So balancing these two while maintaining a firm grip on the cost that we commit to the business is what the subject of profit leadership is all about. So if you really deep dive into what are the generic levers for profitability, they include timely product introduction, how optimally we manage our working capital, how well we flow information and material, and how efficient our distribution network is. Now, each one of these levers, depending on which industry we operate in, will have varying degree of impact on profitability of the firm, right? Now, timely product introduction, I was giving this example to the Plastic Manufacturers Association some time back. And you know, in conversations with one of our friends in the plastics industry, I learned that you know, when the time to develop a mold in the plastic industry in India is much longer than how long it takes to develop a mold in China, and this is part of the reason why even many of the Indian plastic manufacturers, they outsource their mold development and manufacturing to Chinese counterpart. Now, I find that as a huge competitive disadvantage for Indian manufacturers, because one, we are not able to turn around our orders quickly. And two, of course, there is a capital capital leaving the country, which is disadvantageous to the country as a whole for its balance of payment. Now, this is not an issue. This is not an issue to do with technology, because technology can be bought. This is clearly an issue to do with methodology, how we are organized ourselves as an industry, and how much importance is given to the systems involved in developing new products. Are we really diligent in streamlining these processes, take out wasteful activities, and speed up the processes? If you see, the pharma industry has set the bar so high recently, right? With the COVID pandemic, the whole world was waiting with bated breath for the vaccines to be developed, and you know, how they turned around and, you know, introduced a vaccine within a year, which usually takes anywhere between 3 to 10 years to develop a vaccine. So there is clearly great merit in speeding up new product introduction, of course, without increasing the risk exposure. Working capital is another burning issue. There are wonderful researches done. One among them is by a gentleman called Richard Schoenberger. Richard Schoenberger happens to be one of the early thought leaders on Lean. He wrote pretty much the first or second book addressing the subject of just-in-time in the early 1980s. And he did a multi-year research, which he published a couple of years ago, which is available if you Google it. In this research, he looks at the working capital performance of industries, including automotive industry, which is supposed to be the leader, pharmaceutical, electronics, and multiple other industries, where he has done a multi-year study, a very unbiased study, because he simply studied the balance sheet and the financial reports of these industries. And he found that without an exception, all the industries across the board have had a depleting performance in terms of inventory turnover, which means that they are having to hold greater amount of inventory to achieve similar or growing sales revenues. So this means that industries have progressively taken the eye off the ball in terms of keeping their working capital performance in check. Now, there are many plausible explanations why this has happened. Part of the reason is the attractiveness of global sourcing, where the landed cost of most items and components today is very attractive and gives us a cost arbitrage. So sometimes we trade off in terms of greater inventory cover in the pursuit of what they call as opportunistic buying or low cost buying and so on, without looking at the big picture in terms of how it impacts the working capital performance of the firm and how it weighs us down in terms of generating greater shareholder returns. So a more balanced view is in order. One is not suggesting to not take advantage of global sourcing or opportunistic buying opportunities. But at the same time, there are many modern tools available that can help us to strike a perfect balance between low-cost sourcing and most optimal inventory cover. There are principles like demand-driven MRP, pioneered by Carol Patak and Chad Smith, which addresses a very scientific approach by which we can strike these balances. In a nutshell, the gripe is that industries have taken the eye off the ball in doing serious efforts to address these challenges. So there are a number of profit leakages across the value chain. And unless one is willing to sit down and acknowledge these profit leaks and commit themselves to very specific actions in this regard, they will continue to erode value. And sometimes when we look at our own industry from very close quarters, these fall in our blind spot. Often arguments are, you know, some of the arguments that we get to hear in our consulting, being consultants and working with a number of industries, that they say, this is how it happens in our industry. Hamara industry mein aisa hi hota hai. And there is, others are also doing the same thing. Now, in my view, this is a very lazy explanation because that absolves one from taking actions. Because in any industry, you will find that the leader always takes advantage of this very sentiment of the followers in the industry. So profit leakages are plenty. This is done through a very systematic exercise. A number of our clients, when we took them through this facilitation process, came up with a list of, I think in my recent experience, one of the transformer industry, which was very hungry to grow and become the leader in terms of market and profitability. They did this exercise about a year ago, which we facilitated, and they came up with a list of about 120 profit leakage points, right from design to estimation to manufacturing, quality control, supply chain inventory management, collection efficiency. The list goes on and on and on. The beauty in my view is that this is not done in traditional budgeting exercise, because traditionally budgeting is done simply to say how much more new customers we will bring, how much revenue we are going to achieve, and what it will reflect in terms of P&L. Not enough effort is invested in any budgeting exercise to look at what is the cost of poor quality, what are the profit leakages and inefficiencies that will remove from the business that will help us to become a profit leader. So Dr. Deming is credited with a lot of these thought process. He was discovered literally in his 80s when he was discovered as a guru that taught to the Japanese in terms of how to run their industries and how to be efficient. Deming talks about speed of response, involving everyone in the process, and zero defect. Right? You can look up his book called The Art of the Crisis, where he talks about what industries are not doing or what industries ought to do to become leaders in their respective domains. So it boils down to methodology, which is often ignored because people again believe that the only way you can become more efficient is to improve the technology. Technology is an enabler, but you cannot improve without methodology. Methodology requires discipline. It requires hard work. It requires people coming together, ask inconvenient questions, challenge the process, challenge the system, and make changes. What technology can do is it can add a layer of easiness to the way the process is run. So time and again, this has been proven without doubt that 80% of any business improvement or efficiency comes from methodology, which is challenging the way we run our businesses. Now in this COVID era, this is time for us to reflect now that the vaccines are being rolled out, and there is a lot of talk about the vaccines not being rolled out efficiently enough. And I find it very painful. I really wish that we as lean management consultants can help some of these distribution centers, because it doesn't matter how good your facility is, how good your infrastructure is. It boils down to, if the vaccine distribution process is not efficiently designed, it will end up choking up, right? There are simple things. I was remembering this eye surgery hospital. There is a famed case study, I think. I'm forgetting the name. I think it is Arvind Eye Surgery, or one of the, there is a fabled case study of how they could achieve hundreds of thousands of patients getting the cataract surgery merely by organizing the operation theaters in a way that the patient could come in quickly, go out, and the surgery done in the least time consuming manner. So everything boils down to innovative way in which we think of our methodology and how we organize ourselves. So the business value stream needs to be rethought, right? Most of the times we are caught up in our siloed mentality, where each functional head believes that they are doing the absolute best within their function, but they care very little about who their customer is internally and who their supplier is. So this becomes a difficulty until and unless we come together and look at the organization as a value stream from start to end. We will not be able to really bring about meaningful improvements. So so this kind of sums up the message of profit leadership. Profitability is always a symptom, right? It has to be a symptom of doing the right processes and getting people together. Unless you do the enablers right, the outcome will be not achieved. So quickly touching upon the consulting approach for profit leadership, it touches upon the elements of the customer, continuous improvement, and making reliable systems. A lot of times it is about getting people aligned towards a shared ambition. So in my view, 80% of, or maybe 90% of success hinges on the leadership commitment, right? One thing we are constantly gauging when we talk to clients or prospects is that how enthusiastic the leadership team is in making changes to the organization in order to challenge the way their organization is run. If we sense that the leadership team is not sincere in its thought process in terms of, that changes can be done and fundamentally the industry can be challenged, there is a great risk in starting that engagement, because it will likely fail, because a consultant always facilitates, guides, directs, reflects best practices, but consultant cannot run the industry, right? So unless the leadership team is deeply committed to making changes, we become a very potent weapon to facilitate the leader to achieve his vision and ambition. So the themes cutting across operations, people strategy, sales and marketing, product development, the ambition, the missing link, what we find is translating the ambition into execution executable initiatives. Most organizations, they do their business planning at the start of the year, maybe the last quarter, and they come back and review their performance again at the end of the year. How part of executing those strategies is not very clearly articulated. And there are multiple reasons why this happens, right? We inherently assume that people know what are the right things to do without equipping them with the right skill set and the right best practices. This is what we are trying to address also, to bridge the gap between ambition and execution of the right initiatives. So there are a number of steps that we go through it. One thing that we focus on a lot is education. So there are a lot of workshops and leadership onboarding and so on. And I find that these are great avenues for the leadership team and the management to really reflect on their ideas and thoughts. Oftentimes, they struggle to get external validation of their thought process. How viable those ideas are, have others done it, what are the best practices, and so on. So this helps to also bring about a lot of awareness and education right from the top to the middle management of the organization, so that opens up their thinking and also helps them to start to look at opportunities and so on. So unless the mind opens up, you will get very little change. So I find most of our so-called coaching sessions and workshops, 80% of the time and energy is spent in change management, where we, through a dialogue process, facilitate challenging of the mindset to make people open up to believe that there are better ways to run their business. So we are not really talking about transactional leadership that doesn't require any great external intervention. We are talking about transformational leadership, which takes a concerted effort over time. So in summary, of course, if you do not change your direction, you may end up where you're heading, right? That's a very simple way to summarize in the words of Lao Tzu. So that brings us to the end of this session. Over to you, NC, if you'd like to facilitate the Q&A.
Thank you, Naveen. Thank you very much. It's a wonderful session. Now I would request the audience to open up for question answer. If there's any comments anyone want to share, so kindly feel free to ask questions. Sarfaraz, you can facilitate in case.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So
the participants are now allowed to unmute themselves. So either you can unmute yourself and ask a question, or you can type in your question in the chat box.
Sarfaraz, hope you have received any questions, Sarfaraz, so far?
No, sir. I'm just waiting. Not received any questions yet.
Would you like to press the call?
So maybe what we can do is, I would like to share one or two questions which are normally asked, during these webinars. So one of the most commonly asked questions is whenever the improvement which all these speakers spoke about. So when companies start introspecting about where they start improving, or they take any help from any outsider, does it require any capital investment to initiate any improvement, start with an improvement initiative in the organization? That's a very commonly asked question. If you can share the response while we wait for the students.
I would request Naveen to respond because he has led many such major training opportunity in the Middle East region. Naveen, would you like to give some case examples?
To the point about capital investment, the short answer is no. There is, I think the investment of headspace is more important in my view, because the most debilitating conversation what we witness is that the managers, let's say the owner or the CEO who's running the firm, wants new ideas, they want change, but the managers generally tend to throw the spanner. I don't want to generalize this statement. This may not apply in all organizations, but more often than not, with the objection that we are doing already the best and we know how best to run our industry, and there is nothing different that can be done. And so overcoming this mindset barrier is the first port of call, or the first battle to win. And once people start to believe that things can be done differently, then you will automatically start seeing a number of ideas come on board. You know, in our experience, the 99.9% or let's say 99%, we'll leave the room open for 1%. 99% of the answers lie in reorganizing the work without any capital expenditure. Maybe 1% of them may involve capital expenditure, which are welcome, but not at the expense of not changing the mindset. So that's how I look at it. I hope that answers the question, Sarfraz.
Yes. Thank you, Ravi. There's one question on the chat asked by Mr. Chetan Vyas. So I'll read it out. He's saying business cycles are getting compressed. How does an entrepreneur deal with highly volatile business environment? I think this would be also a question from so many people.
Great. Let me attempt this, and I would request Naveen and Ganesh to supplement if I missed any points. Of course, as he rightly pointed out, the kind of a scenario we had maybe pre-COVID or even a decade ago was fairly predictable and stable, unless otherwise there are business-related seasonality variations. But the current world trend is bringing in many variability, which is far different from any entrepreneur would have faced. So that means our organizational design, if I may have to permit to say that, the organizational designs are generally to cater a very stable situation. So I'm coming from automobile and auto ancillary. So maybe 25, 30 years ago, before the Japanese kind of a technology came into India, the industries were organized based on a very predictable kind of market situations. But in anticipation of the kind of a variability, customer expectations, market situation, economical downturns, so these industries have redesigned their entire organizational business models. I would not get into detail, so when time permits, I can definitely talk about it. So they have been made in such a way the organization becomes robust. Just to cite an example, the inventory is one of the major concerns where the current cash flow situation, the working capital becoming a very big problem for many industries. So our earlier way of forecasting and then production planning, scheduling, or manufacturing systems, etc., they are all designed for a high level of predictability. And we are continuing to use the same kind of approaches, even in a very volatile kind of situation. So that's one of the reasons that industries are where Ganesh can cite some examples where he's working on right now. So they are finding a huge amount of issues on, they're not able to keep up their delivery commitment. I don't know about the FGI industries, but in India, average delivery against commitment is less than 40%. So that means 60% of the time we are not able to keep up our delivery commitment. So coming to the international market that is opening up, so we cannot operate on those kind of situations. And one of the reasons why China virtually grabbed the world market is to bring in that predictability. So to answer the question that we need to look at different kind of a management systems, which are at least available, because we are not going to reinvent the wheel. The demand-driven MRP systems are available for the entire production planning and control systems, which can help for the volatile scenarios, shifting from forecasting to demand response kind of a situation. Or the manufacturing systems, which are made more into a flexible manufacturing systems. So I don't know the gentleman who asked this question coming from what type of industry, but nevertheless, I think it's a time to really look into the business systems right now. Naveen, Ganesh, if you have anything to add?
No, absolutely right, NC. And I'd like to also stress that when you mention system, don't think that these are IT systems. The word system, word itself can give a wrong meaning to many people. What NC means by system is the whole method of doing the activities from planning to delivery has to change.
True. Yes, Efras?
Yeah. All right, sir. Thank you, Naveen. Thank you, Ganesh and NC. Now, there's another question from Sir Deepak Badgujar. He's asking, is there any role model organization structure available for different types of industries in comparison to China to reach to MSME percentage increase which lead to GDP growth? So, he's asking for a role model organization structure. Is there any structure which is different from what they would have in China that is leading to their GDP growth?
So when you say structure, I think if I've understood correctly, you may be referring to the organizational structure or probably...
Yes, role model organization structure. I think that's what he meant. Yeah.
So having worked in a significant number of MSMEs in the past 20 years, even during my corporate career on the ancillary industries, most of the MSMEs are entrepreneur driven. That means the founder virtually controls everything. And probably some of the industries, when I did the interview, asked the people, whom are you reporting to? Everyone said, I'm reporting to the director. So virtually most of the organizations, organically or inorganically grown, have never focused on the structural aspects, neither as Ganesh has pointed out, they were willing to invest on bringing professionals into the organization, but the family members horizontally, they were controlling the functional responsibilities as well. So as far as maintaining the status quo is concerned, it is fine. So this cultural aspects that we have in India, where even I'm board advisor in some of the leading companies, so they have a hesitation to even to share powers with the succession, second generation or third generation coming into the business. So there are a lot of aspects which needs to be looked into for MSMEs to remain as small, but behave like a large corporate. So there's no one single answer to give a cookbook approach for structure, but it requires a lot of introspection and changes. Of course, some of the industries I'm working, the first thing we are doing is laying our hands on the structure. As Jim Collins always used to say, you must have a right bus on the going in the right destination with the right people on board. So that is what is the most critical aspect as of now. And we have an HR expert in our team who also deals with these aspects of HR system. So when anyone wants any help, please let us know.
All right, sir. Thank you for that information. It's 1 o'clock. So before we wrap up and proceed and hand over to the FGI team, I would like to say on behalf of FGI and SSA team that any company who wishes to deep dive into the solutions that we all discussed today, FGI will be coming up with more in-depth programs, where we will be assisting them in helping the industry to deal with the new normal, helping you to apply some of the solutions that we discussed today in a more systematic format. So we are ready to give you guidance, and we both are here to serve you and help you build the nation. So do keep this thought open, and the team from FGI will be connecting with you shortly on this. You can always write them. If you have any interest and you wish to connect with them, do write it. And also, I will be sharing a link in the chat for requesting your feedback. So please share your feedback. This will help us improve. and work better for our next webinar. So over to you, Mr. Dave.
Thank you, Sarfraz. There was one question by Ankit Shah asking about, you know, the GM equivalent portal at Gujarat. Well, you know, the there are no such portals, but a couple of companies are trying to create such portals, and one of them is SAP. They are coming up with such portals. We are going to have a program on that very shortly, Mr. Ankit Shah. So just wait for, you know, further details. We'll share with you. You can join in and get, you know, more perspective on that. So since it's already 1 o'clock and we had an excellent session, I would like to propose the vote of thanks for the esteemed guest speakers, Mr. N.C. Narayanan, the founder chairman at SSA Group of Companies, Mr. Ganesh Iyer, vice chairman of SSA Business Solutions, Mr. Naveen Narayanan, managing director at SSA International LLC, the esteemed participants, ladies and gentlemen, I'm indeed having a proud privilege to propose the word of thanks on behalf of FGI to the veteran Mr. Narayanan, N.C. Narayanan, Mr. Ganesh Iyer and Mr. Naveen Narayanan for their useful presentation and also answering the queries of the participants. I'm sure based on the deliberations that held during the webinar today, the participants were able to gather knowledge on profit leadership, which will be useful in the upcoming year. We would like to launch a series of programs on profit leadership under the title of Profit Leadership. We'll send in more details. I would be really happy if you share us the feedback. We'll share the feedback form with you after this session today. You can share the feedback with us, and we would also connect with you in person to understand your takeaways and also your expectations from such workshops. So I would like to thank all the participants to join in for the webinar today for making this as a great success. Before we end this meeting, I would request everyone to rise above for the national anthem, please. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining.
Thank you, Mr. Dave, for a wonderful session.
Thank you.
Take care. Have a nice day.
Thank you.